Hello and welcome to Chapel of Change TV, where we give fresh hope to families and the city. My name's Ron Roberson, I'll be your host today, and we have a very powerful program lined up for you that deals with the power of forgiveness. So many people in this world are trapped in a web of anger and bitterness because they haven't allowed God to empower them to let go. If you're struggling with anger over past hurts, you don't want to miss what God has for you today. Let's take a look. Wow, what a powerful story. If I had to give a title to this particular program, I guess it would be A Lesson in Forgiveness. And here to teach us that lesson is Jackie, whose son was killed tragically back 30-odd years ago. Jackie, welcome.
Thank you.
So happy to have you here. And I tell you, I've fallen in love with you since I met you, because you are someone who has just really done something remarkable that has been effective not only to those in your family, but to me and others also. So thank you so much for the courage and taking out your time to come and be with us.
Thank you. Thank you for allowing me to do this.
Now, before we get into the tragic story, tell us a little bit about your son.
David was a young, vibrant kid. He was very smart in school, but he made poor decisions sometimes when he went out, you know. And 15 years old, he was, I think, like any normal child, where he was a little bit rebellious. He was little this, little that, but pretty much, you know, pretty much a good kid, you know.
Tell us about your family at that time. How many kids did you have, and where were you living?
Well, I was living in Carson, California. And I had five children, and I was self-supporting, all five of them. Four boys and one girl. Being boys that I had to be kind of a little bit rough, because boys are boys. And then, of course, I had my daughter. I worked, and I supported my children, and we were a pretty close family. We were, I mean, back in, each one of the kids had their room, but somewhere along the line, they all ended up in my room, just sleeping on the floor just so they could be next to Mama, I guess, you know. But we were very close, very, you know, very happy.
Very happy. And then, sadly, this tragic occasion took place. David was 15 years old.
Yes.
There are parts of this that I've heard that said that the shooting might have even been gang-related. Let's take you back to that day, and I know it's a little difficult for you, but if you could, as much as you can remember, tell us about that particular day.
Okay, well, it was on a Thursday. I came home from work, and I was going to cook dinner. Mm-hmm. At that particular time, David used to have a phone in his room, but his phone bill came extremely huge that I couldn't afford. So for his punishment, I took the phone out of his room. And that night when I came home from work and I was cooking, he goes, "Mom, Mom, please." He was just about begging for me to put that phone back in his room. And I told him no. I said, because I cannot afford the telephone bills and this and that. And he said, okay. He said, "Can I go over to my friend Phil's house?" And I said, yeah, because that wasn't part of the punishment. Punishment was no phone. So as he was walking out, I had remembered that I had to buy a present for one of the girls at work, a baby shower. Mm-hmm. So I told him, I said, "Look, be back in about 45 minutes. I'm gonna go down to the mall, down to Sears, buy the baby gift and come right back." So I packed my daughter And her and I went to Sears, and I had dinner half cooked, so I knew I wouldn't press too much time for time. Mm-hmm. We went to the mall, and I bought the gift. I hurried up, and I came home. Just as I drove up to the front, and I turned off the key, I looked up, and I seen a couple of my children at the front door with the door wide open. And I couldn't figure out what it was. I just happened to look up. I was in shock. Well, just then, that second, Brian took out running from that door. He looked like he broke loose from whatever.
That's Brian. Brian is, yes, Brian. Your son that's here with us today. Yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm. He broke loose and he yells out, "Mama, Mama, David's been shot. David's been shot." Mm-hmm. That's, wow.
Now, what did you do after that? Did you? I understand that you rode with him in the ambulance to the hospital.
No, mm-hmm. When Brian said that, I went hysterical for a few seconds, mm-hmm. and then I turned around and I was yelling, "Where is he? Where is he?" And everybody told me they did not know where he was. I said, "How dare you guys tell me that my son was shot, and you can't tell me where?" So I stopped and I had to stop and think. I said, "Okay, if somebody got shot, where would they take them?" I said, "The Harbor General." So my boyfriend came over and I got in the car and he said, "Where do you want me to take you?" I said, "The only thing I can think of is the Harbor General. Nobody else knows where he's at." So I remember he took off and I was hollering and screaming. Just hollering, I said, this can't be. Mm-hmm. And we passed by this street, 189th, and I looked to my right, and I seen an ambulance and the lights and all this and that and that and this, and I looked, "No, that's not him. Just keep going, Larry," and I'm hollering, I'm screaming, oh God, what's happening? And all of a sudden I stopped. I just stopped as Larry was driving. I just stopped crying. I stopped yelling. "He's been shot in the arm. He's been shot in the leg. He's been, why are you doing this to yourself? He's okay. So we finally made it to the Harbor General, and he said, "Where do I drop you off?" I said, "At the emergency. That's where he's at." I said, if he's here, So I jumped out of the car and I ran inside and I grabbed the first nurse I could and I said, Is my son here? I said, I need to know now because I need to find the hospital he's in and I'm taking a chance. And she said, "How old is he?" I said, "He's 15. She said, "I'll be right back." And I said, "Okay." So she left and I stood there and I was just fumbles all over. 30 seconds went by and it seemed like forever. She didn't come back. So I grabbed another nurse. I said, "I have got to know if my son is here or I need to go find me the hospital that he's at. Please go look. I need an answer now." She said, "Do you have a picture of him?" And I said, "Yes." So I looked in my purse and I grabbed the picture and I gave it to her. 30 seconds later, she'd come out. And she said, "Will you follow me, please?" And I said, "Okay." I thought she was going to take me to where he was laying in the bed. She put me in the bloody room. It was ugly. It was just, I guess they must take blood tests or something in there because there was like blood on the floor, blood on everywhere. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking, what am I doing in here? Mm-hmm. And just then the doctor was right behind her. And as he was at the door, he goes, "Would you like to sit?" And I look at him, and I went to sit, and I was halfway down to sit when I looked up at him and I said, "He's gone." And I remember being halfway in the air to sit, and he went like this. And I just sat, my whole world exploded right there. It just fell apart, And I'm sitting there by myself in this bloody room and I'm just looking around. And when I looked up is when I seen my mother. And I guess she'd found out. I don't know how she found out. And she said, "What happened? What happened?" And I said, "David is gone. David is, he's gone." She said, "No, no, no." And there was nothing else to do but to leave him there. Mm-hmm. And I walked out of the hospital by myself. Mm-hmm. Though my mother was with me, I just didn't want nobody to touch me. Yeah. I didn't want them to touch me or nothing. I just walked out. I just felt so hollow. I was numb, just totally numb.
Yeah. Jackie, I know this is tough for you, and I just thank you for taking the time. Did you find out anything about the circumstances that related to how he was killed?
Well, I went home and I was trying to figure out what all happened, and one of the kids come running up, and first they told me about Paul, my other son. Paul had ran up to him. This was after he was shot. He was on the floor and he was shaking, and Paul thought he was alive. And he ran to him, tried to pick him up, and they took him away from him. Mm-hmm. And at that point, I guess that's when someone came to me and told me that it was Duffy that did it.
I said, "Did you Duffy? Know him
no,
prior to that?
No, I don't recall, but you know, these were teenagers. Mm-hmm. And for me, I would much rather see my children bring their kids, their friends to my house than I would my children go to their house, because I didn't know what kind of a, you know, overlooking their parents did. I know what I did when I, you know, so whether they were good, bad, or indifferent, there was a lot of kids that was in and out. So, but I kept a close eye, you know, walking in the bedrooms abruptly. But I said, "Did they catch him? Did they catch him?" They said no. They said no. And they said it was Duffy that... I said, "What happened?" And they told me that Duffy and David had gotten into an argument a couple of days before at the drive-in. And that night, when David was at Phil's house, his friends, when he asked me if he could go over there, he'd gone in there and called his girlfriend and went outside, and he was alone sitting outside when Duffy drove up on a bike, and he was sporting this gun. And David looked at him and said, "You know what, I think you need to get out of here." David was a very respected guy, so he wouldn't question him as far as, you know. And he says, "I think you better get your butt out of here." He said, "Take that out of here." And they said Duffy got the gun, pointed it at him and said, "Oh yeah?" He goes, "I got a bullet in here for you." And he fired, and there was a bullet.
Wow. So there were also conflicting stories, right?
Yes.
That was one version,
that
and
was
then
one.
What was the other? Something to do with an accident or something? Or?
Well, I didn't hear about that till years later,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
I stood with that story in my mind for many years.
Wow.
And, but it was my own conclusion. Oh, I did hear that he did get the gun from his uncle. It was in the closet.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when he approached David because of what happened two nights before.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so. And but I drew my own conclusion as to think that no child in their right mind would do that purposely.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but this was the first 6 hours before they caught him, okay? I hated him. I wanted to just destroy him.
Mm-hmm.
There was everything, every raging thing in my body to come out. And about 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock is when they told me they caught him. They say they caught him under a bush.
Mm-hmm.
That's the story that I got.
Right.
And at that time, I finally calmed down. I calmed down a little bit. And after that, I was so busy trying to straighten out my own children, because they fell apart. they just totally, they were really not listening to me. They were, Paul immediately took the number one, how would you say, the number one place in a line of children. He was a typical middle child, and all of a sudden he's boosted to the front, or he boosted himself. And he was rough on the kids. He was, I'd be at work and I'd get phone calls and everything that he was whooping up on them because they wouldn't listen to him. I mean, it was just, and at the same time, I wanted to know deep within me where my son was. Was he in heaven or was he in hell? And I searched and I searched. There was times when I would sit by myself and I'd start to grieve and feel and this and that, but I had to jump out of that. I didn't have time for me to do that. I was too busy, you know, taking care of this child, taking care of that child, you know, looking to where David was, you know, where did David,
what happened?
And
what happened to him?
My son is in heaven.
With Donald, what happened with Donald?
They picked him up, and I didn't hear nothing about anything about him. No one told me nothing. Mm-hmm. About 6 months later, I was at work, and I got a phone call from the district attorney. Mm-hmm. And she told me that if I were the judge, what would I do to Duffy? Mm-hmm. And I was taken back. She said the judge had to weigh it 50% into his sentence. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, I was at work, I was at my desk, and I'm going, how do I answer this? How do I answer this, you know? But at the same time, I had already come to terms with myself that I couldn't believe that he knew there was a bullet in there. I just couldn't. Mm-hmm. I just, you know, my heart went out to him at the time. You know, it was like, and if I didn't believe that, then I would fester. And I didn't want that.
Yeah.
I didn't want to feel the heaviness in my heart that I did those 6 hours, because I was very, you know.
Yes, indeed.
And so at that point, I just said, you know, I don't believe he knew there was a bullet in there for him. Mm-hmm. I think he just probably had it, and it just went off, and that's how I, you know.
Yeah. Also joining us is Pastor Brian Worth, pastor of Chapel of Change Christian Fellowship here in the city of Paramount, and he is Jackie's youngest son. Pastor, if you would, I know you're quite young at that time. Tell us your thoughts on that particular day.
Yeah, I remember moments of it, Ron. I remember them, a neighborhood kid coming up to our door, sharing with us that David had been shot. Mm-hmm. I remember the tension that my family felt, the grief. I remember running to my mom and yelling out to her that David had been shot. And even though I was a little kid, I still can feel the grief and the tension. And it really, it devastated our family.
Mm-hmm. As a youngster, do you still remember that day vividly now?
I remember it clearly. I remember, mm-hmm. I remember being in the room and hitting the wall out of frustration or sadness.
Yes, I remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And did you seek revenge? Did the family look to go after the guy?
Or? You know, I was too young at that time. It was all about burying David, and you know, we didn't have no money, so they had to raise money. The neighborhood kids came and kind of did like a fundraiser. So I wasn't in them circles about revenge. It was the grief just crushed us. So we didn't have time to think about anything else.
Mm-hmm. Really tragic time. What did you notice most about your mother going through the grieving process?
Yeah, I just remember the tears. I remember the sorrow. I remember the look of confusion. Mm-hmm. and the look of what are we going to do. That type of looks all throughout that time, is look of confusion, look of grief. A lot of people came in and out the house at that time because of the grieving process. Like many people kind of converged on our house, family members, kids from the community. And it was just a time of major, major grief.
Mm-hmm. Well, when we return, Jackie will meet Donald for the very first time publicly. Just prior to this taping, Jackie met with Donald privately. Let's take a look.
It's the hardest thing to give away, and the last thing on your mind today. It always goes to those who don't deserve. It's the opposite of how you feel when the pain they caused is just too real. Takes everything you have to say the word forgiveness. Forgiveness. In the face of all your pride, it moves away the mad inside. It's always anger's own worst enemy. Even when the jury and the judge say you got a right to hold a grudge, it's the whisper in your ear saying set it free. Forgiveness. Prisoner free, there is no end to what its power can do. So let it go and be amazed by what you see through eyes of grace. The prisoner that it really frees is you. Forgiveness. Forgiveness.
Okay, welcome back, and as you can see, that was a very, very touching scene that took place right here at Chapel of Change in the main sanctuary. And what a blessing it was. I had an opportunity to witness that, and it really, really touched me. Joining us is Donald, and he's responsible for the death of Jackie's son. And first of all, sir, let me say, you've already done the time, and you've already gone through all that process. It's been many, many years. You're living in Louisiana. You didn't have to come here. No. You didn't have to come here at all. You could have gone on about your business for the rest of your life and all would have been fine. But you chose, after making a connection with Pastor Brian, to come and meet this great woman face to face and to tell her your story. Let's just get right into it. Why did you decide to come? What made you come?
Well, I wouldn't have never rest. It wouldn't have never been peace with me. Mm-hmm. And it was never fine. Mm-hmm. And I always wanted that opportunity to speak with her.
Yeah. Let's go back to that day. You'll probably be reliving this over and over because I believe this is going to end up being your testimony and your message to thousands of other people.
Yes.
Let's go back to that day. What kind of a day was it? What kind of relationship did you have with David?
It was a good relationship, it was a tight friendship, you know. When we was in the skateboard world, you know, it was me and him a lot. Mm-hmm. But as we got a little older, I guess, and we chose to do the gang role, we separated a little bit.
So were you in both rival gangs?
Yes.
But you still remained friends?
No, we was in the same gang, yes. Mm-hmm.
And but you were in the same gang?
Yes.
And so what was happening? What was life like when the two of you would get together with the other folks?
Well, we was always in the inner circle with each other, you know. We was always friends with each other, you know. And as kids growing up, you know, just hanging out with the grown-ups, doing what they do, and mm-hmm. having fun. I guess we call it fun, drinking and smoking. And mm-hmm. I don't think he did any much drinking or smoking, but I know I did a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That day, what happened that morning when you got up? Walk us through that whole day, if you can.
Well, that whole day, that morning, someone had gave me word that there was a rival gang that was coming down, and they knew that I had a gun. I had recently had stole the gun from my uncle, my cousin, really. And they knew I had one, and word had got around that a rival gang was gonna come and try and mess up the party, mm-hmm. you know, shoot up the party. So they just wanted me to bring mine for protection. Mm-hmm. So throughout the day, like, it really wasn't on my mind about the party, because I fell asleep, and I was in a deep sleep that day, and a friend of mine came banging on the door, and he woke me up out of my sleep. And my grandmother gave me a look like, don't go out that door, it's not, you know, just don't go out. But I was young, and I was disobedient at the time, and I went out and got on a bicycle with a friend of mine, and we rode to the party, and it was a little bit around dusk, a little bit before dark, you know. And when we got there, pretty sure it was kind of dark at the time, and everything was already going on. People was drinking, partying, music was going. It was full, pretty much full already. And the people that was my age that was hanging out with me, we all was outside and in a circle, you know, all in a circle just talking, and they wanted to see the gun, and they wanted to play with it, and you know, everybody was grabbing at it and reaching for it, and I knew it was loaded. So I reached, you know, I had got some bullets. I shot off the gun a few times prior before that, and only had one bullet. So a friend of mine gave me some other bullets, you know, and the bullets that he gave me fell out, but the original one got stuck in the chamber. And I thought they was all out, so I threw them in my pocket, and we started playing with the gun, and a couple of them was clicking it at each other, you know, playing, and when it came back to me, and...
So you mean clicked at each other,
yeah.
And the guys were playing around,
yes.
As if it was empty?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And when it came back to me, you know, and he was saying, yeah, that gun is fake, and this and that, and I used the terrible words as, this gonna blow your head off, and... You know, my hand was like this. It wasn't really pointing at him, but it was towards him, and it just went off. Mm. And it shot him. Mm. And I seen him go back, and then I seen him fall to the ground, and I ran in the backyard where everybody was. It was kind of like in a carport. And I ran in the backyard. I threw the gun in the trash, and the bullets in the trash can, and I ran back out there, and I was telling him, I don't know if I was saying get up or, you know, are you okay, or I was just, everything was black around me, and I can see people running, screaming, and all I know is I felt a friend of mine tugging my shirt, telling me to get out of here, leave, just leave, go, and I jumped on a bicycle and I pedaled a couple cities over.
Mm-hmm. After the shooting, was there anything in the party that may have turned them against you, or what was the feel of the atmosphere right when it happened? What?
Everyone was in shock.
In shock. And you all were youngsters, huh? 15,
yes.
16?
Yeah. Yes.
Wow. Now, again, as I mentioned to Jackie, there's several versions of the story.
Yes.
And there is one that they had out that said that you might have been jealous, and also that you had a beef with him prior to that. Speak to that, if you will.
Well, you know, as kids, you know, we was in the skateboard world. I guess you can say we was kind of soft or mm-hmm. whatever. So when we was in the gang, between the two of us, we pretended to be, you know, tough towards each other. And we used to throw rocks at each other and chase each other and play like we was really serious, but deep down inside we wasn't, you know, because every social event we was always in that circle together. Mm-hmm. Every party, you know, he wasn't far away, I wasn't far away, you know, we always, it was us couple people always in that circle, tight friendship. And, you know, people didn't understand that relationship, you know, they thought I was really truly being angry at him. Mm-hmm. When it was just that I was trying to be tough, someone that I wasn't.
Wow. How were you apprehended?
Well, like I said, I took off. I went to an aunt's house. I went to a friend's house. Mm-hmm. And then I decided to turn myself in. And they waited till I got underneath the bridge for, if, you know, I guess any altercation would take place. It was safe without traffic or anything. So they blocked me off under a bridge. And they arrested me. They asked me, you know, where was the gun and everything, what happened, and I told them. And they took me in. I heard over the speaker saying that they had the gun and the bullets and stuff, and they took me into the jailhouse, and I don't know how long afterwards that I got a chance to talk to anyone. I couldn't talk. Mm-hmm. I was crying all through the night, and I just broke down.
This was your friend.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So how did the court proceedings go? What was the final verdict?
Well, I think the next morning I got released.
The next morning?
Yes, they ran ballistic tests and they said, well, your story matches with what you're saying. Mm-hmm. You know, they can tell that they wasn't no full grip on the gun. So they released me in the custody of my mom. And I went through court back and forth there, and they was gonna release me then again. Mm. But I told them, I said, I don't deserve to be released. Mm. I need some time for this. And they gave me five, they probably gave me more years than that, but I did five off of it. Mm-hmm. That I can remember.
Yeah. Now, that was quite some time ago.
Yeah.
And did you have any contact with Jackie or anybody in the family
prior to
a year ago?
I wanted, when they released me, I wanted to go right over there, but they advised me not to. Mm-hmm. And they said that they would arrest me again, you know, if I attempted, because I'm gonna cause too much of a commotion or a problem. Mm-hmm. Somewhat to that extent, I was young. Mm-hmm. But I remember they told me just to stay away.
Yeah. So many years had passed, and how many? About 30-some years passed, right?
Yes.
And you got a phone call.
Yes.
And how did that go? Who was it and what happened?
Well, it was Pastor Brian. He was reaching out to me, and it was hard.
Yeah.
I didn't want to talk to him at first. Mm-hmm. I couldn't. But he ministered to me. Mm-hmm.
Your life had changed by now. You were a different person.
I'm an assistant pastor. Mm-hmm. 23 years that prior, you know, I had dedicated my life to God. Mm-hmm. And, he started ministering to me.
Pastor Brian.
Mm-hmm.
And?
It took about 2 days.
Mm-hmm.
For me really to talk, and then he's wanted me to talk to his mom, and I think it maybe took another couple more days for that. It was just hard.
Yeah. And Pastor Brian, you found him on the world famous Facebook of all places.
Yeah, Ron. It was interesting because I've always been inquisitive of what happened that night, and I've heard different stories and different versions, and there's been a lot of contradiction as to what really happened. And so I remember I messaged or I sent a communication out to one of my older homegirls. And I asked her if she knew the guy who killed my brother. And the way I remember what happened, she said, you know, not only do I know him, but he's on my Facebook. Do you want to see him? And immediately, Ron, I was like, no, I don't want to see him. I didn't ask you that. I didn't ask you I didn't ask that. I just want to know, did you know him? Maybe wanted to get some information as to what happened that night. So that was a shocker, because I'd never seen Donald. The closest I've come to him is I remember seeing his gang name on on the cement, written on the cement when I was a little kid. And so when she said, you want to see him, it was a real shocker. And at first I didn't want to see him, but I just felt God tugging upon my heart. And, you know, I kind of just remembered how, you know, all my life I've been in tough situations, and God brought me through tough situations. And so this was just another tough situation to walk through. And I went on his Facebook page, and I believe I seen his picture for the very first time. And then I walked away, and I said, oh my good. I said, no. I said to myself, no, no. And I was talking to myself, probably talking to God, really, because I felt a tug in my heart to send him a message that I forgive him. But I said, no, I don't want to do it. And I kind of struggled with that. But again, you know, I chose to obey what I believed was God leading me to do that. And I sent him a message. And I think about a day later, he responded. And what kind of moved me was in his response, he of course immediately apologized. And I was just looking for answers, what happened that night. And he went to explain what happened to that night, but it was so emotional that he had to stop, like in the mid thought, and he gave me his number. He said, you know what, I have to stop here. Call me up if you want, you know, call me up and I'll talk to you. And that started the conversation.
So you set up a phone call with your mother and Donald.
Yeah, the way that I remembered it, you know, the Lord led me to that next step, but I didn't know how to tell it to my mom. So I think what I did was I sent her an email, and I communicated through an email because it was much easier for me just to write it down. And my mom, by the grace of God, agreed to have a conversation with Donald. And I asked Donald, and he agreed. But I noticed there was a little bit of tension on Donald's side because of the gravity of his offense. And so I knew in my heart that he's going to have to process this and walk through it. And it's not going to just be immediately like he's going, oh, let me do this. But I think within a day or two, I was able, by the grace of God, to facilitate a conversation for the first time ever. And I remember my mom expressing how she was so afraid, she was scared, and she was shaking. But the Lord gave her the grace to have this conversation. It was just a powerful moment, and Donald apologized to her. And my mom, you know, my mom has always been a strong lady, and she is just a pillar. She's a pillar. And we know that's through the grace of God, gave her the grace to forgive him initially over the phone.
So Jackie, how'd that phone call go? How did you feel when you heard his voice for the first time?
It was the hardest phone call I ever did hear in my whole life. I never dreamed I would ever speak to him or anything, because I knew he was in Louisiana, because every now and then I'd ask somebody, and that was all. But when the phone call came through, I'd just gotten home from work, and Brian said, Mom, are you ready for this? And I said, yeah. And I just, my whole body was just, it was like just vibrating all over. And he gets on the phone, and I know I was in tears through the whole telephone call. I felt like I don't know what, talking to him, but I got the questions out. And I'm thinking, should I believe him, should I not? But I know I should, because he's answering them. He's not hesitating. And then I'd ask it this way, then I'd ask it that way. And the last question to him was, what was the date all this happened? He came out with it within a couple seconds. And I knew then what he had told me. But I was just, it took me about 5 days to calm down from that telephone call.
Wow.
It did. It was like, it took me about 5 days, but we got out what we both needed. You know, And I was glad and feeling good about that. It was just the initial shock, mm-hmm. you know.
Yeah. All the years that have been passed, from day one, I wanted to. From day one. Mm-hmm. And all the years that have passed, you know, to up until that time, I finally got the chance to. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't like I expected to be. Right. You know, it was hard, it was hurting. Mm-hmm. You know, but it was something that I wanted to do, you know, for a long time. And it was a blessing that he had called and contacted me and gave us that opportunity. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm in the ministry and I'm helping thousands of people and I can't even help this situation. Mm-hmm. But through the grace of God, you know, he made a way that we could speak.
This would be your opportunity now to publicly, if you will, speak directly to Jackie and tell her what's on your heart.
I'd like to apologize for all the pain that I may have put you through, your family through. And I just pray that, you know, that we can heal from this in a sense, that we can be at peace. And I truly, truly am sorry for what happened. If it could have been me, I would have took it. And I'm sorry for all the pains and years we went through. And just when I accept, we can, you forgive me.
Duffy, I forgive you.
Oh, thank you.
I want you to go on with your life and be the happiest you can be. Because from this day forward, I will hold a lot of peace in my heart. This was weighing heavy for many years. Yes. And I guess just to see you. And I think we both deserve to go on and feel a little comfort, you know, better than what we had yesterday or the day before, you know. I want us both to have that, and I want you to have it most of all.
Yes, that little 15-year-old was released yesterday.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes.
Well, we had an opportunity to witness a very special moment. Jackie and Donald, along with Pastor Brian, went to the gravesite where David was buried. Well, it's very powerful indeed, and it's really touched me. I've spent 30 years in this industry, and I've done all sorts of stories, but nothing, absolutely nothing has touched me like this. Pastor Brian, I think a prayer would be most appropriate right about now.
Yeah, let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for bringing us together today. Your hand is upon this. And Lord, we thank you for releasing all of us today through this forgiveness, through this example of your grace, through this example of your gospel. We thank you for releasing us from the pain of the past. We pray for my mom that you continue to strengthen her and be with her. And we also pray for Donald, Lord, that you strengthen him and use his story to touch other people's lives. Help him to speak how you have given him this gift, not only of eternal forgiveness, but forgiveness down here on earth. Bless Donald as he goes about this next season of his life. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.